Smells like winter, huh? Yes, it does. We had the most interesting day the other day. I was filming the last program with the two new dogs. Tiki and Tanner, yes, the two new dogs. I had a blast with that. And by the way, thank you. Thank you, everybody. I want to start out with that, and I won't go on very long. Thank you, everybody, for your support. I really do appreciate it, and all the nice comments. It was actually really fun. Rascal does like those two dogs. I don't know if I mentioned that or not, but yes, he does. He sniffs their butt. They sniff his butt. That's their way of saying hello. And there have been no fights whatsoever. All three of them sleep in my bed. And they're very comfortable with that. So I'm thinking those two probably slept in the bed of the woman who used to take care of them. They just crawl underneath the covers, and I got three little dogs moving around underneath the blankets. It's really kind of fun. But today, I wanted to come out and do some gardening, but I had to do some cleanup first. Because a few days ago, we had this wind come through, and a lot of people in the United States, they know what I'm talking about, this wind, the storm came through, and there were tornadoes. There was, I think, two tornadoes in Iowa alone. One of them was a ways down the road, but we got this little burst that had crazy hail the size of quarters, which really doesn't sound like much, but it was coming down with a ferocity I've never seen, and I've lived here for a few years. It was coming sideways like this. And it was hitting the windows and the dishwasher's bedroom. And he thought it was going to break his windows. That's how bad it was. And it did some damage over here on the side of the house. It knocked over this huge branch off of this big tree, you know, the big elm tree that's next to the house. And there was this huge thing in the garden. And it's a good thing I wouldn't grow in the garden. Otherwise, I would have lost some plants. And we had to haul this big tree-like thing out of here. So I took down this fence, makes it easier to get the tree thing out of here, and we got it over to the pile, you know, where I'm doing the wildlife and stuff. So that was pretty good. But my life never ceases to be interesting. So it broke one of my gutters. It hit the roof of the house, knocked off two shingles, brand new shingles. I just had my house shingled, remember? It was a year ago or something like that. Knocked off two shingles, bounced off of that, hit my garden. It would have killed me if I'd have been in my garden. And it knocked off one of my gutters, my downspouts, and the hail came through. And on the basement, it just busted through the plastic guards for the basement. You can see these big old bullet holes in there. But we had that done. That's bad, but you know what? That's Iowa. No big deal. So I filmed the episode of the dogs the next day. And that was fun. That got my mind off all the damage that happened around here. And there was no permanent damage, just a bunch of limbs down. And as soon as I filmed that episode, I felt really good about that. I went inside, put the camera away, and I came back outside to start working on the garden because I wanted some time to myself. I love those babies. I love them. I do. But I needed time for me. So I came out here and I started working on the garden, and I went in to wash my hands. There's no water. And that's not a good feeling, okay? There's no such thing as a good feeling when you walk inside and you turn on the faucet and nothing comes out. Things are supposed to come out of that thing. Well, out in the country, you can't call the water department. You are in charge of your own water. So I thought, crap. I checked the fuses. Everything was fine. The breaker box was fine. Everything was fine. I was checking everything. Okay, let's just make it short. I'm checking everything. Everything's fine. I thought, what? Could you give me a sign? And it turns out a quarter mile away, which is where my well actually is, way down the hill over there. I've shown you that. It was a control box on my well that went out. So we're racing the clock. We had to get to the one store. We live in the middle of nowhere, so it's not like you can go to your local Home Depot or anything like that. Oh, no, 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 no. The pleasures of living out in the country, you got to go find a store that actually carries the parts. And then out of those stores, you have to find the one that carries the model that you actually need. Hey, Rascal, come here. Hey, how you been? He's eating grass inside the garden. Hey. Show YouTube your butt. Wag it at him. He actually likes this. Don't you? Yeah. Oh, he's enjoying the new babies. This is what we do. We've been doing this for years. I pick him up. I support his butt with my hand and his shoulders on my shoulder. And we just look at the sky. And sometimes he'll close his eyes and his head goes back. And he just enjoys the heck out of it. Life is so good, isn't it? Say hi to everybody. They love you too. You smell good. You smell like country. Okay, he's going to go out and chew some more grass. But, oh, by the way, when your dog chews grass, that doesn't mean they're sick or there's anything wrong with them. Dogs need vegetables. And in nature, you know, wild animals will eat meat and then they'll chew on grass for their vegetables. So if your dog is eating grass, don't worry about it at all. Dogs eat grass all the time. Anyway, back to what I was talking about. My well was all broken. I finally found one store in the entire county. Actually, it was in the next county that had the part that I needed. So we're racing all the way over to Atlantic, Iowa, to the one store that has it. That's closing in a half an hour. And boy, was that a joyride or what? So I had to fix that. Anyway, so that's why I didn't get this done. I was prepping everything. I have a point. I was prepping everything so that I could turn on the camera and show you how I'm changing my strawberry bed. But life happened, and so I had to leave the fencing out. I had to put the tools away. Life had to be put on hold so that I could take care of life. And but I'm back. It's cold today. It's windy. And look. Look at this thing. This is a microphone cover, also known, and I hate this word, but that's what it's called. It's called a dead cat. Yeah, that kind of sucks. That's a horrible name. I'm just going to call it the little fuzzball. Yeah, that sounds a little bit more humane. And I want to apologize. Last episode, I noticed, well, I didn't notice. Other people noticed that one of the speakers on their thing wasn't working, and they're freaking out. They're like, Ray, what's wrong with, I'm not hearing it right. And I heard it right, but that's because I adjusted my headphones to where I could hear it. And I thought, well, there's nothing wrong with the volume. Turns out my new wireless microphone, it was a little bit wonky that day. Yeah, that's the technical term we use in gardening, is wonky. And it was only recording on one channel. So I'm hoping this is recording on two channels, because there's no way to know until I actually film the whole video and take it back in there. I have no way of knowing. It doesn't show on camera, doesn't show on here. Well, that's what you get for buying second best. Anyway, let's get back to this. This is the fun part. It's windy, I'm cold, but I really don't care. You know, it's that first gardening program. I got to get out here and I got to do it. Otherwise, I'm just going to die and I'll be chewing on the walls. So I came out here, I got this all ready, and I wanted to explain it to you because folks have been asking, Ray, how do you get your beds ready for spring? And I thought, well, what better way to tell you than to show you? And I'm also doing this because I'm so sick to death of all of Mother Nature's creatures eating my strawberries, and then all I get is half-chewed strawberries. You know, I work really hard for these things. I don't mind sharing, but come on, at least let me put one of them in my mouth that doesn't have chew marks on it. Last year, I ate strawberries with chew marks on it. I know that's going to creep you out. You're like, Ray, why would you do that? I'm like, I wanted a real strawberry. I didn't want to have to buy them. And I'd find these with chew marks. I thought, well, I could just rinse it off if I don't tell anybody. And that's what I did. I'm such a pig. I hate myself. But you know what? They were delicious. These are called honey-o-y, I don't know. I butcher everybody's name. It's called honey-o-y. I'll put the name right here. A friend of mine, a viewer, who turned into quite the friend, and that's a weird thing. My viewers start out as viewers, and they tune in, and the experience turns into something they don't really expect. And I didn't expect it in the beginning, but now it's just part of the game. They start out as viewers, and they look at the videos, and they go, oh, well, you know, he's kind of different. He's kind of nice. I kind of like that. But then once they start staying a while, they realize that I'm actually interactive. I'm not one of those people where you post a comment and you never hear from them. A lot of people said, oh my God, you replied to me. I thought, well, I really didn't think there was anything big about it, but yeah, you asked a question. Of course I'm going to reply to you. A lot of people don't do that. I do that. I'm an interactive gardener. You know, when you want me, you got me. I'm right here, okay? And nothing special about me. I'm just a guy with a garden and a camera. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask them. So, okay, I just lost track of what I was talking about. Well, anyway, yeah, whatever I said. Here's my strawberry bed. I wanted to cover it up and put some fencing on top of it to keep the birds away. But I also wanted access to it. And the last time I tried this, I did it up when I lived in my previous place. I just put a big old piece of what's called hardware cloth, and I'll show you what that stuff is. It's really fine mesh fencing that's wonderful stuff. I would lay it on top, put a couple bricks on, and whenever I needed strawberries, I have to take the whole thing off. And I thought, you know what? There's got to be a better way. And so I thought about it. And there's many different ways to do things, but this is the Ray way of doing things. I'm not recommending you do this. I'm just showing you what I'm doing so that maybe later in the season you see this and you go, that's actually not a bad idea. Or you'll think to yourself, that's a really stupid idea. Okay, what I did was, on the side of the coop here, I have some scrap lumber. And this is nothing. This is just 2x4, and I believe it's spruce And you can see that it's stained, it's a little moldy here and there. Some of them are a little bit warped, but not too much. And you can unwarp these when you start putting brackets on them if they're long enough. They do bend just a little bit. So a little bit of a warp isn't a bad thing. When you're buying them, it's a bad thing. But if they warp a little bit after you've had them, not so bad. Anyway, I'm dismantling a few pieces of lumber out of the chicken coop because eventually that chicken coop's coming down. And I want to get all the best lumber out of there because I don't want to waste anything. I hate wasting stuff. I'm not a cheap guy. I hate wasting, okay? That's the difference. So anyway, these can be repurposed. These can be reused. And that's what I'm doing. I had a couple new ones. I used those. And I also had some old ones, so I'm using those. This is my lumber pile. I know, I really should put these indoors, but you have no idea just how small my house is, so I don't really have a whole lot of room inside my house for that. And come on over here, and I'm going to explain this to you, because I did the boring stuff, so you don't have to stand there and go, oh my God, he's putting another screw in. Check this out. Yeah, take a look at that. That's what Rascal does. And then he sees me seeing him, and he's like, oh, I wasn't doing anything. And then he comes running over like there was nothing going on there. I caught ya. And that's what I want Tiki and Tanner to learn, the joys of actually, I call it splendoring in the sun. They just flip over and just start rolling in the sun and take a nap out here. Oh, it's going to be a wonderful life. Okay, let's get back to what we're talking about. Let me move you. Hold still. Don't worry. I won't drop you. You can trust me. I'm a gardener. Okay. Ooh, now that's a good view. I like standing behind the camera. I really should have been a cameraman. Okay, here's what we got here, folks. Rascal, what's in here? Get the mouse. Are there mice in here? Huh? Look. Ah, it moves. It moves. Look at this. Yeah. This is my hinging frame. Yes, I used 2 12-foot long pieces of 2x4, and I measured them out the exact same size as my original bed here. See, my problem is that the birds were eating the strawberries. I wanted to put a top on it, but I didn't want it to be this low because the strawberries grow up about maybe 7 to 8 inches, and I want to give them room and also have some air coming in there. So I don't want anything smashing them all down. So I had to raise it up, and 2x4s were the logical choice. Now what that does is it gives me another 4 inches worth of height, and these will have plenty of room to move around and spread out in there. And I started this out, by the way, with, I think it was 23 strawberry plants sent to me by my benefactor. His name is Ray. He lives in New Jersey. He's an older gentleman, and he's one of the guys that turned out to be a really good friend. And he keeps bugging me. And I love this about him. He asked me once, well, would you care for a few strawberry plants? And I said, well, sure, if you have a few you want to get rid of. And he took that and he ran with it. So he sent me all of these asparagus that I'm growing. He sent me more asparagus roots. He sent me strawberry plants. He sends me potatoes every year. By the way, I'm going to be doing potatoes this year. 2 different kinds of potatoes, courtesy of Ray. And so he likes doing that. He was feeling a little ill, so he gardens vicariously through me, and I'm very happy to help him out, and I'm very happy that he helps me out. Anyway, back to this. So I built this out of 2x4s, and then I cut these out of the used ones right here for supports going that way. Otherwise, these would go wobbly. And I have some brackets on here, and I want to bring you in extra close because I want you to see this, just so you'll know exactly how it's built. I didn't want to show you me building it because that was the long, drawn-out process. And one thing I mentioned a long time ago is that once in a while, you need to stop, turn the camera off, and take some time for you, because that's really important. I gave that advice to people who were starting a YouTube channel. If you want to be successful and you want to keep yourself balanced, save some of you for you and do some stuff just to recharge yourself. And that's what I was doing. I wanted to show you this, and so I saved parts of it, but I also wanted to work with myself, and that's what I did too. So anyway, come on over here and take a look at this. Hey there. How you doing, Toothless? Let's go over here and I'm going to show you these brackets. This is what holds it all together. Just common L brackets. And for those of you who are concerned about made in the USA, yes, they are made in the USA. They're only about 50 to 60 cents each, and you can get them at Home Depot, Lowe's. They're very inexpensive. They are handy to have. I make all of my raised beds out of these things. They hold tight as a drum. Now, a common way of making a raised bed is to put your 2x4 up against another 2x4 like this, and then take some screws and put them through there. That is a very good way to do it, but I prefer not to do that because it's just not my preferred way of doing things. I like the L brackets because it holds it well, and it doesn't put a hole into the wood, and then I have it going through right here. It just never held well for me. You know, everybody has their own experiences and their own ways of doing things. I'm not giving the definitive way, I'm just showing you my way. Now on the back side, you can see these hinges. These are just regular common economy hinges that you can get at the hardware store. They only cost a couple bucks. I put one on this end, and about every 3 feet I'm going to put one. I'm going to put one right over here, about where that cross piece is, that piece of wood. I'm going to hold off on it because I want to show you how I do this. It might help you when you're doing yours. There's another one, and there's that one over here. That's how it hinges on there, and that is very strong. That's going to hold for quite some time. You notice that I didn't paint it. I prefer not to paint any of my beds or to give them any kind of finish at all. I love the old natural wood look. It looks rustic, and it lasts for ages and ages. These beds are going to last pretty much my lifetime. You know, they would last a little bit longer if I finished them or painted them, but you know, that's just not the look I want. I love that old wood look. See the old bed here? The bottom of it used to be the same color as the top, so within a year or so they're both going to match, and they still have all the strength. It's just on the outside that it gets that weathered look, and so there's really no problem at all. Now, I did mention hinges. I wanted to show you something, and I want to make sure that I take the name and fold it back. I don't want to get sued by a company for saying something bad about their hinges. This, let me put it over here so you can see it. This is a common everyday hinge. They come in metallic, a regular silver color or gold. It doesn't really matter. That's just the outside finish. Now you'll notice they come with screws. I don't like that. Look at how tiny these screws are. This is a big hinge, big holes, and it's supposed to hold a lot of weight. And then you got this itty bitty screw that, you know, that belongs on a Barbie dream house. That isn't going to work. That isn't going to go in very far and hold very well. So I always just throw those screws away. I don't need those. I buy my screws, and these are longer screws. Take a look at this. They're a lot longer than these. They have the flared head, and this is the beveled head, and it goes right in there. It sinks right in there. It holds perfectly, and I always recommend that you get the Phillips head screws. Phillips head, for those of you who are beginners, and I'm not, I tend to be a little bit redundant because I don't assume you all know everything. That would be kind of stupid of me, okay? Phillips head is a cross. Standard head or flat head is just the one slot. I always recommend going with the Phillips head because your screwdriver will go in there better, it holds better, and it doesn't slide off. I've sliced my hands many times with a flat head screw when the screwdriver goes off of that. I always recommend Phillips head screws, okay? And these ones are definitely not stainless steel. People will recommend going with stainless steel. I've always used these. These are the powdered finish. The dark ones are called drywall screws. And most people who work with tools, they'll say, Ray's an idiot because he's using those and you're not supposed to use them outdoors. You know what? I've never had a raised bed fall apart on me because of those. So there you go. Proof is in what you see, not in what you hear, okay? And then a cordless screwdriver is what I use. One guy asked me, he said, Ray, could you explain your tools when you're using them so that people will know, because some people might not know what tools to have. And I'm not going to endorse any particular brand. This is a cordless screwdriver. All it is, it means that you don't have a cord going to your house. And that's kind of inconvenient, especially when most of our gardens are far away from the house. This is battery operated. The battery, let me show you over here. The battery just slips in, clicks in there, and you have one speed. The one is the slow, high torque for putting in screws. And then, see how fast that goes? Then you put this to two, you have the fast speed, and that's for drilling. So you have screwdriver, drill, and it also has reverse in case you need to get those out. Let me tell you something. Using a screwdriver, a hand screwdriver, hey, that's okay. You know, if you got all day and you got the muscles for it, I'm getting a little older and I don't want to have to sit there and push in on these because my joints on my thumb are getting kind of bad and they hurt a lot, even when I'm using this. So after a day of doing this, I have to rest my hand. So this is priceless for me. And I wanted to show you how I do this. This is just a sample. That's why I said I put that all together except for a couple little pieces, because I didn't want you to have to sit through an entire episode of me building a raised bed. There's no need for that, okay? Let me get a screw and I'm going to show you what I'm talking about here. This is my little demo. I hope you like it. Come on over here back to the raised bed. Right here is where I'm putting the last of the hinges. Here's the hinge, here's my screwdriver. And by the way, I have some tips for you on gardening, so please bear with me. I'm gonna keep those to the end. I wanna hurry up and get this done in case the wind gets any worse. And then I'm gonna show you something that I've learned over the years about strawberries, okay? Hold on just a second. Come on over here, get your face right down here, and I'm gonna show you a little tip I have for getting these hinges on nice and easy. Oh, this smells good. You pull the grass and stuff aside. I'll be raking this out later, but for right now, you pull that aside and the smell of the fresh dirt comes out. It's an absolutely great smell. Now, back to what I wanted to tell you about. These hinges, they go back either all the way here, or if you flip them this way, they'll go back part of the way, okay? So what I do is I want them to go back all the way, all right? That way I can open up the door as far as I want. So you do that. You open it up all the way, you face this towards there. Now, what I'm doing is I'm setting this hinge. It actually has a little back on here, right here. And then you just set that right there. And then we're gonna take this, and normally you would just put a screw in there, right? Well, who's gonna hold this while you put the screws in? You have to hold the screw with one hand, you have to hold this still with the other hand, and then you have to put the screwdriver up here and put in the screw with the other hand. I don't know about you, but I was born right and I don't have three arms. So what am I gonna do? Well, here's what I do. I take the head off of this. This is the drill head with the Phillips head thing. Toss that in my pocket and pull out. Where is it? Where? It's somewhere in my pocket. There it is. I just have a drill bit. And find a drill bit that is just a little bit thinner than your screw. You don't want it the same size because you don't want to remount that hole the same size as a screw. Otherwise, it's not going to hold on right. So what we do is we get a drill bit just a little bit smaller. We tighten this up, slide that in, and then we tighten it up. Now, we're going to put it on number two, which is drill mode. Then, I can hold this up, make sure that it's still in the same position. Okay, it goes all the way back there, and you can actually feel it seating on there perfectly, all right? Now, what I'm going to do, put it right in the center, drill a little hole. You don't have to drill the whole hole. All you have to do, three little ones. Set this aside. You don't have to drill the ones on the bottom. Those come later. Drill it in. Pull it out. That brings out the sawdust. There, your hole is ready to go. Pop this out. Pop this back in. Now, everybody, like I say, everybody's got their own way of doing things. This is how I do things. It's probably not the most efficient way, but it's my way, and I'm comfortable with it. Now, I got this hinge ready. All I have to do, just pop this on, hold it with my hand, pop it on screwdriver, slowly, and this has variable speeds. The lighter you pull on this, the slower it goes. See, so we start out slow. Seat it in there, get it in there just a little bit. There, nice and seated. Hear that sound that it makes? That's the torque on here. You can set that as light as you want or as heavy as you want. If I do it as light as I want, it goes like this, but it won't put the screws in very far, and when it gets so tight, it just clicks off the gears. It doesn't strip anything, but see, it won't turn anymore. The more you turn it, the higher the number, the more torque it has and the more it wants to pull. If you do it all the way over to 15, you can't even hold that. That is gonna push it right in there for the most stubborn screws. I like to put it right about in the middle, about 7.5, because if you put it too much of a torque, sometimes you'll put a screw in there and it'll just keep turning once it gets in there, and that's no good. You just stripped it out. Probably not the best decision you made that day. All right, here we go. Straight on. Always make sure that these go straight in. Don't put it at an angle. Don't do it like that. Do it the right way, okay? Have this facing down, level it out, and take it nice and slow. apply a little bit of pressure. There you go. That is my little tip. I know it's just a very simple thing, but then again, it can make the difference, the whole difference between frustration and not enjoying it and getting it on the right way. Now, I did this for a reason. I do things for a reason. Hold on. I got 3 more screws to get. That's what I didn't do. Hold it. Don't go nowhere. Okay. Now, the reason I didn't drill out the bottom holes is because I don't have to hold this hinge. And the reason this hinge is going to fit nice is because the other 3 are already in there. I set this right in the center, seat it like this, and it starts clicking when it's just tight enough. Whoops. And that's bound to happen. Don't feel bad. It happens to the best of us. Take it nice and slow. There you go. Now the reason I say there's a proper way to doing this is because if you do it like this, it's going to hurt your wrist a little bit. And it's just not good. And it also is hard for you to really get the angle just right. So it's better to do it the right way. Take your time, hold it right here, and that helps brace it. We are all set. That's how I put in my hinges. That's how I put in the brackets. It's just that simple. That's my little tip. Now, let's get to the fun stuff. Now, this roll of fun stuff is what's called hardware cloth. All it is it's very similar to chicken wire, and be very careful handling this, okay? Because there are sharp spots that can cut you. So wear gloves and be very cautious. I'm not wearing gloves because I'm stupid. All right, you can get this in varying widths. You can get it in 1/4 inch, 1/2 inch, 1 inch. The squares will be as big or as small as you want. I got mine, I believe, in 1/2 inch. That is going to be small enough to keep the mice out unless they're very, very tiny. And yes, I know mice can fit through very small areas. The thing is, you have to know what type of mice you have. Some mice are smaller than others. I have the larger type of mice. I don't have those itty bitty ones that some people will have. Those can fit right through here. I'd have to get the 1/4 inch. I opted for the 1/2 inch, and they all cost about the same. So I went for the 1/2 inch, and that is just fine for me. That'll keep the mice out, and it will definitely keep the birds out. And let me set this over here, and I'm going to show you something that'll probably help you when you're dealing with this stuff. Okay, I think we're ready to start. I thought about this, and my original intent was to measure this out. Roll out the hardware cloth, measure it out to the exact dimensions of my raised bed. But being the lazy bum that I am, I figured out a better way. I put the roll of it over there, and then I just pulled it all the way across the bed until it was right at the end over here, and it was lined up along this edge of the 2x4. And my idea was, why don't I just do that and then attach it at the end and then attach it as I go all along here, and then I'll just slice it off here, slice off the excess, and I'm totally done. That way I don't have to, because, and I only say this because, I suck at measuring. I don't know why I can measure exactly, and for some reason it just doesn't seem to work. So that's one of my weird little things about me, is I don't measure well. I don't know what it is about me. I guess I just wasn't raised right. Now, to attach this, you can use a regular staple gun. You can use nails. You can use anything that you want. My poison of choice is this. This is run by an air compressor. This is an air stapler. And this runs off of air from a air compressor hose. Now what I do is I click this, it opens up, and here are the staples. They're all attached, and they're extra long, and they're going to hold for a lifetime. I just set them in there, close this up, clicks into place. Now, I've already dragged out the air compressor. Mike the dishwasher was nice enough to let me use it. And then you just take this. I'm going step by step because I want to show you how I do things. From beginning to end, that's what we're going to do. You take this part of it, if you ever get one, pull back that little quick disconnect, and pop it on really fast and let go. And there you go. Not a problem at all. And don't worry, this thing ain't gonna, you know, shove staples out and hit you in the eye, because this has a safety feature. This little thing right here has to be pushed in order for the trigger to work. See? I can't make any staples come flying out of this, even if I wanted to. That's a wonderful thing. Tools can be dangerous, but they can also be your best friend. So, this has to be pressed firmly against the wood in order for this trigger to work. It's a wonderful thing, and it saves me a heck of a lot of time from having to nail down things. So, you only need to put one of these staples about every 4 inches or so. You could probably put them a little more apart, but I like to keep them once every 4 to 6 inches. That's going to hold it. I mean, we're not trying to hold Godzilla in here. We're just trying to hold on this fencing just a little bit. So you don't really have to go too awful crazy on this. Now, what I did was I took this whole edge and I put it down there. So that is really ready to go. Now, what I'm going to do is set my shears over here. Make sure that this is straight. Come down here. And then just start working my way over to this one. Nice and easy. Take your time. Don't rush yourself. This can actually be a fun process. You know, gardening for me, and I hope for a lot of other people, isn't a chore. And people will say, I'm working in the garden. Well, that's just a term. I think of it as I'm able to spend my time in the garden because it's never work for me. It's just something that I really like to do. Sitting behind a desk, dealing with employees, figuring out payroll, that was work. And that's one of the things that really stressed me out the most, is having to deal with the ins and outs of business. And this was my one outlet, and it really helped keep me sane for quite some time. And right now it just keeps me happy. I come out here, I spend time in the sun, I go back in, my hands are dirty, I'm a little bit tired, and boy, do I sleep good. Okay, we have that done. I'm gonna work my way down. I'm not gonna bore you with that. I'm just gonna hit this with a few staples, this with a few staples. I'm gonna not do that side at all because I need to slice it off, and I don't need it pushed all the way down. I'm gonna slice it before I attach it. So hold on a second. Let me finish this part off. We'll come right back and finish off the last part of this. Just place it down, push, hold it in place, and look at that. Nice and smooth. It takes that entire staple and pushes it all the way in. It's beautiful, and it's fast. Looks pretty good, huh? It's gonna keep you out of here. It's rascal proof and bird proof. And this is what it looks like. Get over here. And I can just take it down like this. Set it down. And I can open up my strawberry bed. Yes, yes. I will be putting bars on either side of this to hold this door up. But that's for another time. All I wanted to do right now was to get this bird proofed, because the strawberries are actually starting to grow and they're going to be producing this spring. Now I'm getting to the part that I promised you. What are you doing digging in my garden? Hey there. How you doing? What's in here? Keep the mice out. Yeah, he's pretty good about that. But no, I wanted to show you my spring prep for my strawberry bed. There's a thing that I do in the fall and a thing that I do in the spring, and they're both very, very simple. And this is gonna help you to get the best production that you can out of your strawberries, because they're delicious. And with almost no care at all, they're gonna be filling our kitchens full of fresh strawberries. Come on in here and take a look at what early spring looks like in this bed. Looks kinda peaked. It does. It looks kind of rough. But this is what I'd like to do with my strawberries in the fall. Okay, let's start with in the fall. Once your season's over and it's getting cooler, I'm talking about the mid to northern climates. In the south, this doesn't apply to you, of course, because you have this crazy growing season that does, it isn't even human. You have a good growing season. Those of us that have actual winters where it gets cold, our strawberry plants will do what's called dying back. That's not actually dying, that's just a phrase. It should be called going into hibernation because they don't actually die. Just the top part dies off. The roots and the crown, which is where all the roots and stems come together, that stays alive. It just goes dormant for the winter. So in the fall, I just let my plants die back naturally and go dormant. They get crispy and crunchy. And what that does is it forms this barrier, not a crunch down barrier, a light barrier. And then when the snow falls, there's an insulation that's formed, okay? Where there's air, there's insulation. So when the snow falls on here, it may look pretty bad, but underneath the snow, there's actually room for air, and that keeps them from freezing too awful hard. And that preserves the roots. In the spring, here's what we do. Once I see signs of growth, like over here, you can see this one. See the new leaves? Yeah. You can see some of the green stuff here. Once you start noticing that, and the snow is off of these, and hard freezes are done for the year. You can get a few little frosts, but once basically the chance of hard frost and freezes is over, come out to your garden and pull out everything that, I don't even know where that came from, some kind of weird piece of wood. Things fall, okay? These are around trees, so you never know what you're gonna find. I got turkey feathers. Yep, I have everything in here. What I do is I go through and I just gently do this. You don't have to do this, and you can wear gloves if you want. I'm just not a gloves kind of guy. I like to feel everything with my hands. Life is short. So what I do is I crunch these up. And what this does is it breaks them into smaller pieces, and they filter down to the bottom. And that is food for worms. Crunched up dead leaves is a buffet for your worms. So the smaller you get them, the better they are. They're going to hit that soil. They're going to moisten up. It attracts worms like a magnet. It's just like putting on the dinner bell. Worms come up. They munch on all this stuff. They turn it into worm poop. And that is helping your garden. And also the tunnels that they make. It's like a web work of tunnels with the worms. And that allows moisture to get down there, nutrients to get down there. It's a wonderful thing. So you want to encourage that. And so you got to feed your soil. You can't just throw things in here and expect them to do all the work. A garden is an interactive process where we work with our plants and we give them good care. They give us good food. And everybody's winning here. So you can actually take this with your hands and gently, if you want to, I'm not saying you have to crunch up your leaves, okay? There are more paths to the destination than just one. You can gently rake out the leaves if you don't want it unsightly. And what that does, you can see a little nub right here. That's new growth. It brings it out to the sunlight. Now you can actually pull these leaves out. This is another method. Gently, don't use a rake, because a rake is really harsh and it can't feel like your fingers can feel. This is your rake and it's your best tool. Oh, look at this, a rock. Where did these things come from? That didn't fall off a tree. Anyway, you pull these things out, and by the way, early spring is the best time to do this because it's just wonderful outside. It's brisk, there's a breeze blowing, the sun is shining. Take these leaves, if you don't want to crunch them up and feed them to your worms, throw them in your compost pile, and that will break down into good nutrition, and you can sprinkle that compost right back into your strawberry bed any time of the growing season that you want. It doesn't matter. There is no right or wrong time to fertilize your strawberries. Whenever you can, drop in some compost. Just crumble it in like you're crumbling the topping on a cake or something like that, and it'll be just fine for your strawberries. Don't rake hard because you can rip these things out by their roots, and that is the simple prep that I have for my strawberries. Yes, it's not scientific. No, it's not difficult. It's very simple. But then again, if you don't know how to do it, then of course you need to know, you need some information. And that's what I'm here for, to give you simple, common sense information based on my experience. This is nothing I read in a book. This is stuff I've learned. I've killed a lot of strawberry plants, okay? So I've paid my dues, so you don't have to, all right? I'm gonna rake these out. Because, and the only reason I'm raking these out is because I threw in a lot of compost last year, so I know this soil is good. What I'm doing is I'm going to pull out these leaves, and that way it can get the warmth of the sun and get these things growing, and I have tons of compost already made that I can add back in here, so I don't need these leaves. But some folks, when you live in a city, or you don't have your neighborhood association doesn't want you to make compost, or you don't want to stink it up to bother your neighbors, take these and just crunch them up. Crunch them up in your hand. Put them in a bucket. Set your kid out there. They're eating all your food. Get them out there and get them working. Make them crunch up these leaves. Kids are going to love it. Just say, hey, let's crunch up some leaves together. It's something that's fun. You can all do it. And it's feeding your soil. Well, as much fun as this has been, I got to get going. I can hear the little ones barking on the inside of the house. I can't have them out while I'm filming because I have to focus on what I'm doing. And little one here, Crackhead, he goes everywhere and they want to follow him. And gosh only knows where he's going to drop them off. I don't trust him yet. Rascal dog. Rascal. What's in here? Get your mouse. Get him. Smells pretty good, huh? Yeah. Well, he's got mice to look for. I have some leaves to crunch up. I hope you enjoyed this episode. First episode, really, the first episode out in the garden. If you have any questions concerning your strawberries, anything having to do with gardening, the little ones, you just want to say hi, post it in the comment section below. I'm always here for you. I'll be sure to get back to you as soon as I possibly can. I keep him working. Thanks, everybody, for joining me on the farm. I really do appreciate it. Have a great day. Rascal. Sniff my leaves.
Yeah, that's good stuff.
That's really good. I don't know what this is. Ooh. Ooh.